Hey folks, it's Mira Dessy, the Ingredient Guru, and I am here today to talk to you about something that's super important to me, and I believe it's also important to you, which is why I wanted to share. As many of you know, my family was affected last August by Hurricane Harvey, and unfortunately we were flooded out of our home. Here we are 8 months later, and the home is still kind of ripped up, but in the process, we've had an awful lot of things going on. And one of the big changes for us was that we chose to move, to leave that home. We're going to repair it and then sell it. But in the meantime, we're in a new home, and the home that we're in is in a very suburban area. And so that means highly treated water. And for me, that was a really important issue. I tend to be sensitive to chemicals and things like that anyway. I also tend to be really very particular about the kinds of things that I put into my body and into my environment. So we tested our water. We did put in a whole house filter. And I know that for a lot of people, this is not just an issue that affects me. This is something that affects a lot of other people. So I brought in my good friend, Lara Adler. And she is the environmental toxins expert. She's kind of like me for the environment. And she is just my go-to resource when it comes to understanding these kinds of things. And I wanted her to share with us about what we really need to know about water. Lara, thank you so much for being here.
Of course, Mira. Thank you for having me. Obviously, we're not going to do our regular chit chat for 2 hours that we normally do when we talk. Well, this will be focused on water. Mira and I talk all the time, and our phone conversations are like hours long and rambling. So it's wonderful, but we'll keep it focused. And yes, what you experienced with the flooding and as lots of other people experienced obviously kicks up all these issues around what we're being exposed to in our environment. So for a lot of people, it was mold. I know you had mold issues. And you know, there's also issues with the chemicals that are in our water. And I've been teaching about water and water filtration and contamination for 6 years now. And still the number one question I get in my business is, what kind of water filter should I get? And it's, you know, it's been a tricky question to answer because there's so many variables at play. And I think that, you know, as people are, especially, you know, your audience and the practitioners that are in your audience, everybody, regardless, we're all looking to optimize our health, right? Mm-hmm. So they are following you because you're educating them about what are the ingredients, chemicals or otherwise that are showing up in our food mm-hmm. that can really interfere with our health. And can lead to chronic illness, which so many people are dealing with. And so this is really an extension of that, right? So as people are optimizing their health, we look beyond food and we start exploring our environment. And our environment, less so in the broader sense of soil pollution and even water pollution and air pollution, but like what's in our home environment?
Yeah.
Right? That's the environment that we're talking about. And so, you know, specifically looking at the products that we're buying and using and bringing into our homes, most people take for granted or they assume that these products are safe and that they've been vetted and tested for safety. And that's not true. And, you know, what that means is that a lot of the products that people are buying and using every day are loaded with chemicals. Not all of them are bad, but there certainly are some bad actors in there sure. that are really messing with our health. And water is one of those things, like even if we're not buying it, right? Like coming from our tap, it's loaded with chemicals. And
so let me ask you an important question, because this was something that, you know, I wanted to know. Obviously the entire Houston and beyond, I mean, all the yes. way from Rockport over to Beaumont and all the way up to, I don't even know how far, was affected. Do they add more chemicals to our water after an event like that?
Sometimes yes, because they're trying to sanitize the water, right? So sometimes what happens is, this can also be the case if there's even extreme rain, right? That causes sort of micro flooding, right? Where if it overwhelms the system, depending on the age of the water system and the way it was built, I can't remember what the terminology is, but there's basically like this flow back system where some of the, if the water level is too high or the flush of water that's come in is too fast and it overwhelms the system, then some of the like unprocessed water gets mixed in. And so to combat that, especially during times of like crisis, a city or municipality might dump chlorine and do a chlorine flush, right? So that's going to lead to this spike in chlorine levels in the water, even levels that can violate the Safe Water Drinking Act if it's like, even if it's just temporary. And that causes problems. You know, most people don't. So the federal government requires that every municipality, every water treatment system sends out a water quality report every year. They're required by law to be sent out or posted by, I think it's June or July of a calendar year. So 2018's has not been released yet. And this report gives us kind of some basic information about how our water is. But if you, and you can find it online, Google it. But there's always a little box on there that says, you know, like, oh, if you're infant, elderly, or immunocompromised, don't drink the water. Oh. And, you know, I look at that and think like, yeah. Well, aren't we all immunocompromised?
In some way.
And none of us want to be immunocompromised. So maybe we should all not be drinking the water. So yes, the short answer is sometimes there are like a chlorine flush that somebody might do if there was a, you know, the threat of bacterial contamination, which is really why we chlorinate our water anyway, so that we don't end up with Giardia, Cryptosporidium.
Yeah, and I mean, I can see that because sewage areas overflowed
yes.
into water systems and everything else, so it makes sense.
But also like farmland, right? So farmland, I mean, I know it's an urban area, but if there's, you know, surrounding farms or wildlife areas, you know, that can flush manure into the water system, those are sources of E. coli and Cryptosporidium and Giardia. So,
sure.
You know, it's so we obviously don't want bacterial contaminants like that in our water because, you know, of all of the contaminants that we're finding in drinking water, those ones are the ones that are going to get you sick right away.
Right. Yeah.
Right? Like those are the ones where you're like, oh, I have, you know, diarrhea that lasts a week.
Sure.
Which can devastate your health, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Sure, because it empties out your gut and it all...
Well, I mean, especially like if you're immunocompromised, if you're elderly, like that can actually be deadly, that type of of illness. And so it is really important to be able to disinfect our water against those things. And the World Health Organization says that, you know, water sanitation is one of the greatest public health advances in the 20th century. Like it's a big deal to be able to say that, like, generally speaking, we don't have to deal in the United States and in most developed countries with bacterial contamination of our water because we have this, you know, advance of technology where we can add chlorine or similar chemicals to the drinking water. But there's also a downside to that. And the downside is that we're getting chemical residues in our water, and then we're getting what are called disinfection byproducts. Disinfection byproducts are when chlorine, for example, reacts with microscopic bits of leaves and just matter, natural matter in the water, and it creates this whole other class of chemicals called disinfection byproducts, trihalomethanes, haloacetic acids, and these are all carcinogens.
Oh,
so it's important for us to like recognize that our water is better than it is in third world countries.
Sure.
And it's not without its problems.
So, and that actually brings up a really important point because a lot of people are beginning to wake up to the fact that, you know, excess chlorine in the water is not good for us. It affects your thyroid. It
yes.
can affect other things in the body. Like it can have other effects. Fluoride, not so great either.
Yeah.
What are some of the other things that are in water that people need to be aware of? And what are, is there a value in doing what I did, getting a whole house filter? Or like, is there something else that you can do to still protect your family without going to that extent?
Yes, and yes. So some of the other, I mean, look, lead in Flint, Michigan, that's, you know, that's a major contaminant. Flint is not the only city, not even by a stretch, the only city where that's happening. And some cities have actually have worse levels of lead in their water than Flint ever had, even at its highest. Wow. So Flint really just kind of rocketed into the spotlight because of what happened. And that was just a mismanagement of the water system. And this spike of lead in the water has affected, you know, thousands and thousands of people. Lead is a potent neurotoxin, developmental reproductive toxin. Like, it's bad news across the board. And so we have heavy metals, right? Lead is one of them. We have arsenic in our water. We have a lot of arsenic in our water, and that enters our waterway through a couple of ways. One, through arsenic-based pesticides. So pesticides that are sprayed on crops, it rains, there's runoff, it runs into the water system, soaks into the ground, gets into the groundwater, and now we have arsenic in our water. Arsenic is naturally occurring, so same thing with fluoride. Fluoride is naturally occurring, so we can have naturally high levels of fluoride in our water, even if no fluoride is added.
Okay.
So we have lead, we have arsenic. Some places have mercury in their water. Mercury in the water is going to be more closely associated with people who are living in urban areas or where there's industrial activity, because mercury is produced from smokestacks.
It comes down through precipitation.
Yeah. It's just like the physical particulates just settle on the ground. And then again, we have rainwater that washes the stuff into the water system. And so, you know, heavy metals are a big one. Pesticides and herbicides are a big one. Atrazine is the one of the most heavily used herbicides in the United States. And the USDA has found atrazine in 94% of drinking water.
Yeah.
So whether you live near a farm or not, these pesticides are able to travel. And, you know, atrazine is not just used on farms, it's used on golf courses, right?
Oh, wow. Yeah, and see, that's something I didn't know. And the community I live in, I think they have like 9 golf courses.
Yeah. So, I mean, when people, if, you know, people are kind of scratching their heads wondering like why maybe like a heavy metals test or a lab test, might show high levels of arsenic in their body, I always ask, like, do you live near golf courses?
Wow.
Do you have well water and you live near a golf course? Those two don't always happen together. But, yeah. You know, there's so many different variables that can determine what's in our water. There's manufacturing chemicals. So there's a number of sort of hot spots around the country that are experiencing high levels of perfluorinated chemicals. These are chemicals used in nonstick materials. They're also found in firefighting foam. So if you live near a military base, they always use this particular type of firefighting foam to put out fires, whether they're test fires or whatever, they're training the military to learn how to put out a fire, whatever it is. That firefighting foam floods into the water system. And a lot of these chemicals are not able to be filtered out by the water municipality, the people who actually provide you with water. They're doing bare minimum of filtration.
Sure. Well, and so it sounds like there's a lot more in our water than we realize. It's just because it's on a microscopic level that we don't really know that it's there.
Yes.
But you indicated that there are definitely some things that we can do to protect ourselves and to make sure that we have the best water available.
We filter. Like, the bottom line is that we filter. And then this opens the door to like this whole other complex problem, which is like, well, what kind of filter do I get? Right. And this is, you know, I teach a whole class on this because it's not like all those people that came to me and said, what kind of water filter should I buy? It was really hard for me to answer that question because I had a million questions for them before I could even get close to the answer. Right. How old is your house? How old the plumbing in your house? Where do you live? Do you live in upstream, downstream? Like, what's the financial, health of your community? Because that can dictate how advanced your water treatment system is. Mm-hmm. There's so many different variables. But the bottom line is that if we're looking to optimize our health and address any chronic disease, whether it's for ourselves or if you're a practitioner for the, you know, for the patients and clients that you see, it's a significant source of exposure to a lot of the chemicals that are being singled out for being concerning. So we have the disinfection byproducts, we have the heavy metals, we have industrial chemicals, we have herbicides and pesticides. We also have pharmaceuticals.
Oh, right? Yeah. Oh, that's, I know a lot of people don't realize that. I remember when I was an adolescent and we were instructed that the best way to get rid of old medicines was to
flush it down the toilet.
I know.
So bad. But even if we're not doing that, right? Even if we never dispose of medications or whatever supplements.
Which you should never do, by the way.
You should never do that.
There's a National Drug Take Back Day every year in April. And
I never know when it is, but yeah, it's good.
It's always April.
Okay, good.
It rotates a little bit, but
okay. But so it's coming from people, flushing their extra meds down the toilet, but it's also just coming from our bodies. Like if you're taking a birth control and you, every time you go pee, your actual body is peeing out unmetabolized excess.
Yeah.
Whether it's estrogen or whatever. And so we're having these chemicals also show up in the drinking water. And what's really interesting, it's really fascinating. I feel like I just want to explore this just for my own sort of edification, because I think it's insane balls, is that you can, through the appropriate testing, you can determine the amount of methamphetamine users in your community by measuring the metabolites in the drinking water.
Wow.
So there are universities that have done studies looking at how can they estimate the average number of illegal drug users, whether it's methamphetamine or heroin or cocaine, and they can test it by figuring out and then extrapolating the metabolites of these compounds in the water system. So they can say, it's crazy to me.
Yeah, no, that is totally insane. And I think, again, that's something that most people don't realize. And a lot of people, if they're filtering their water at all, they're doing like, a Brita filter or a Pure filter, just a tap filter. And that's not really good enough.
It's not good enough anymore. Like there's very few instances in which those will work. But I will also say that anything is better than nothing. So if budget is a real issue and somebody doesn't have the means to buy a more expensive system, anything is better than nothing. Mm-hmm. So the impact or the reduction of these contaminants in the drinking water won't be anywhere near as significant in something like a pitcher filter than in something that goes under your sink or even a whole house system. And so, I always want to make sure that whatever recommendation I'm making or recommendations I'm making, that there's options for people, because it wouldn't really be very fair or very helpful if I just said, well, here's this giant problem and go buy this, $2,000 whole house system that you have to update the filters every, 12 to 18 months or whatever at another expense of $500, whatever it is, right? I'm making those numbers up.
Yeah. But
that's not really a reasonable solution. And so, people are coming into this at all sort of financial walks of life. And so we have to provide at least something that's going to be good for everybody. So yes, a pitcher, generally speaking, is not going to have any meaningful reduction in a lot of these chemicals. And partly that's because the amount of media that's inside those little filter cartridges is so little.
Yeah.
It's just not enough to do the job. And because those are almost always activated carbon filters, and that's it. And activated carbon is a great sort of all-purpose filter that addresses some contaminants, but it's not going to take out fluoride, and it's not going to take out lead, and it's not going to take out arsenic or hexavalent chromium that's in the water. So we need to, and this is why I'm so glad that you said that you went and tested your water before you got your system.
Sure.
There is no one size fits all filter. Like, it just doesn't exist. That's why I could never answer the question.
So there may be some people who are going to test their water and they actually don't need as much as other people because
yes.
of where they're located or how their municipality handles
yep.
water or.
And that's the, you know, it on one hand, we don't want people to, you know, say, oh, I can't afford that like $2,000 thing. On the other hand, why spend $2,000?
If
you don't need to, like, that's yeah. ridiculous. It's overkill. And, you know, sure, you can plan for Armageddon and, you know, barricade your house against all the potential yeah. contaminants in your water. But if you don't have them, don't waste the money.
Right. Yeah. Because then you can spend your money on other things
yes.
to support good environment, good food, good health.
Yes, exactly. So, you know, yeah, it's on that spectrum.
So you mentioned a moment ago that you had a water program.
Yes.
So this is something that people can do where they can learn more about how to understand their water better.
Yes. Yeah, so the whole reason, so I created this course because the number one question I get in my business is what kind of water filter? And rather than having like hundreds of conversations where I have to do all this like research and figure it out for them, I want to teach people how to do that for themselves because
well, yes, otherwise all you do, your entire business would be water consultation.
Yes, exactly. And I really come from the educational place of teach a man to fish so that he can like, don't buy a fish for him. I want to teach him to fish so you can do this for yourself.
Right.
And you know, one thing that's really important to understand is that your water is like a thumbprint for where you live right now. You moved. So if you had taken, let's say, a water filter that you had in your old place and brought it to your new place, it might not have been the appropriate filter for you. Might have left the door open for stuff.
Yeah.
So when you have an understanding of how to navigate, how do I find the right filter for my situation? Then that stays with you forever. And you can right. know, no matter how many times you move, if somebody's a health practitioner and they're working with people remotely, they can educate them on how to do this, or they can do it for them, right? Because I can find out someone's water no matter where they live, and it's actually quite easy. So the idea is that we need to build our filter
right.
based on the contaminants that we have. So just a second ago, I was saying that like, the Brita filters have activated carbon. Well, that's one of, you know, maybe 8 or 10 different types of filter media that are used. And sometimes, depending on the profile of chemicals in your water, you may need 3 or 4 stages.
Okay.
Of different filter media to, like, this one takes out these chemicals, this filter takes out that chemical. So, like, fluoride, for example, there's really only 2 ways that you can get fluoride out of your water. So activated carbon's not one of them. So okay. if you have fluoride in your water and you have a thyroid issue, that's a big deal because fluoride attacks the thyroid, suppresses thyroid function. So
let me ask you, what about for those people, let's say someone who doesn't have the resources to buy a whole house filter, because
yes.
certainly not everybody does. What about the concept of layering your filter? So like maybe you get a tap filter and you have a Brita filter, or you have an under sink filter and you have a shower filter.
Yes, that's actually what I have. So I rent, so I can't use a whole house filter because I'm not spending that on a house that I don't own.
So
I have a filter for under my kitchen sink. I have a filter for my shower. And so, you know, those are called point of use. Like, where okay. are we using the water? Let's get a point of use filter versus a whole house filter. So, and there's options available in all different price ranges. So you can get a under sink filter, point of use kitchen filter that might be $150, $180, $200. Like it's, you know, you can find something that's reasonable.
More affordable, yeah.
Yeah, it's way more reasonable. And so if you don't need something more advanced, don't waste the money. Inversely, don't just go to Home Depot or Lowe's or someplace like that and look for like a good filter, because a good is a totally relative, right? Yeah. So if you, for example, live in an area where even if your city doesn't add fluoride, if you live in an area, okay.
There's like 160,000 people here. I know they're adding fluoride.
Okay. So they're adding, well, you may be surprised. But even if a city is not adding fluoride, there might be naturally present fluoride in the geography and the mineral profile near where their water is stored. So we have to understand that it's like a thumbprint. There's no one size fits all. It's like diet. It's like exercise, right? Yeah. There's no one size fits all diet. In order to find the right diet, have to understand the person.
So it's geo-individual, not
it's,
bio.
Oh my, that's a great way to say it. Yes, it's geo-individual. I love it. I might have to use that.
You can borrow that.
True, but it's true. TM Mira. but it's very true. And so this skill that I want people to have, and that's why I created this course, the skill that I want people to have is how to identify what's in their water, how to prioritize, what do I need to filter out, and then how do I filter it out?
Yeah.
Once you have that skill, it doesn't matter where you live.
Once you know how to do it, you can always repeat it.
Yeah, once you know how to do it, you know how to do it. And I think that that's something that, you know, people don't, they don't even think about.
I think so many people are so used to just, you know, they go to the faucet, they turn on the water and they're done, or they, you know, they're buying water from a delivery service or whatever.
Or they're buying bottled water, which isn't any better. And in fact, can be worse.
I'll link to our BPA video on that.
Yeah. Yes.
Because that totally applies.
Well, also because people are paying, you know, 1900 times the amount of money on bottled water versus tap water, and the bottled water for the most part is just bottled tap water, so it's a swindle,
right? It's a total swindle with a pretty picture on the front,
with a pretty picture that's like, it came from Mountain Spring. I mean, even Poland Spring water is apparently only 30% of Poland Spring is just city tap water.
Yeah,
so it's a swindle, and it's also so unbelievably wasteful. So bottled water is not the way to go, but
yeah, no, glass jar. I learned this from you. Glass jar, your own good water.
Yep. And also I have a glass straw.
Yes. So, I have a metal straw, but yes.
Yeah. Well, if you or anybody listening or watching hasn't explored the world of glass straws, I highly encourage it.
Yeah.
They're amazing.
Absolutely. Well, I'll put some notes down below on that.
Good.
So I have one more thing I want to ask you,
yes,
before we wrap up, because I know you and I could talk forever.
Yes.
There's this whole new phase about something called raw water.
Oh, yeah.
Can you summarize that?
Yeah. So raw water is exactly what it sounds like. There's a new trend. If you Google raw water, you'll be met with some interesting stuff. So raw water is basically unfiltered, untreated water that's coming from a natural spring. Now, in theory, that's great. That sounds amazing because it's natural, right? And in some instances, that water might be totally fine to drink because of the geography. So there is a place in Oregon, I can't remember the name of the town, where one of these raw water companies is actually sourcing their water from, Madras. I think it's in Madras, Oregon, where they have a natural spring. It just so happens that thanks to the geography, that spring water is filtered through, like, I don't know how many feet of volcanic rock.
Oh, wow.
And that volcanic rock acts as like a very, very powerful filter. So the water that comes out of there is pure. Pure. Pure doesn't really mean anything when it comes to water, by the way. So there's this trend of drinking this untreated water, but we have to recognize that the vast majority of water systems in the United States are now polluted, mm-hmm, right? So the majority of our rivers, of our lakes and our streams are polluted. Now, raw water is not coming from a river or stream. It's coming from a spring, which is usually sort of deeper into the earth. But that's not to say that there's not a beaver upstream somewhere further up that's got his beaver dam, or you've got elk or whatever that are pooping, or maybe there's a farm nearby. Yeah. So a lot of the contaminants that we have in our water, they seep into the groundwater. And so what's to say that this water that we're drinking, this raw water, isn't exposing us to chemicals just the same? And the price tag of this raw water is ridiculous.
Yeah.
So if you know that the water that you're drinking from a spring is in fact free of contaminants and free of bacteria or pathogenic bacteria, and you want to go get that water tested in the lab, which I think is a wise thing to do,
sure.
Fine, drink it, have fun, go at it, no problem. But the most of us don't have access to those types of sources anymore. Sure. And the number of sources of actually clean, quote, raw water or spring water is diminishing. So I just, it's got a with warning with that, because nobody wants to get cryptosporidium.
Yeah, no, that's a really sad fact that our sources are diminishing to that degree.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's even in, you know, remote pristine areas, if we have polar bears in the Arctic that have flame retardant chemicals and nonstick chemicals in their bodies, we can't think it's coming from somewhere. And, you know, obviously those chemicals are ending up in those animals because they're traveling through the air system, and that a really deep aquifer into the earth ideally would be, quote, pristine. But if there's not actually an analysis done on this water regularly, because these water contaminants can fluctuate from month to month, let alone from day to day.
Yeah.
It's just kind of a gamble. And for the premium that's charged for these bottles, I think like a 3-gallon jug, glass jug, so that's nice, of this raw water at the Rainbow Market in California sells, I think it was like $36 or something.
Ooh, for 3 gallons? Oh, my.
Yeah, it was just like, maybe it was 5 gallons, but like either way, it's like, no, I'm not spending that.
It's crazy.
It's ridiculous. So filter your water.
Yeah.
You so that's spend exactly $200. If you spend $200 on a filter, that's going to like really clean up your water. It's way better than spending hundreds and hundreds on raw water that might expose you to some type of bacteria.
Yeah. And so I was going to say, really, it sounds like the most important thing that people can do is test their water.
Yep.
And then make sure that what they're getting is what they need. Don't go overboard, and as best as you can afford, don't go underboard either.
Yes. Yeah. And you know, the testing is, sometimes we can glean more information about the quality of our water from our water quality report. There's other ways that we can learn more about our water without having to test.
Expensive. The test wasn't very expensive.
Well, it depends on how much was your test. If you don't,
I don't remember. My husband did it, but I think it was less than $100.
Okay. So that just depends on which chemicals you're testing for, because you can, there's usually the testing services that are available for water vary widely.
Yeah.
So if you want to test for glyphosate,
yeah,
standard lab test is not going to test for that. If you want to test for pharmaceuticals, standard lab test is not going to test for that.
Yeah.
So there are resources that I actually have inside my course that teach it, shows people, sort of points them in their direction of where to, where they can go for testing if they want to go that route. So it's really just kind of laying this buffet of options and education out for people so that when they go to buy a water filter to address this issue, they are more informed and more empowered, so that they're not sort of at the mercy or at the whim of whatever salesman who's like, oh, I got the best filter for you. There's a lot of sort of glossy marketing and fancy marketing on websites. And I think a lot of it is, it's a lot of BS. And I just want people to know how to cut through that and navigate it.
So you'll send me the link to that course so I can
share that? Yeah, absolutely.
Great. I mean, I think it would be great for people to have access to that. You know, for me, I just know, you know, chlorines, chloramines, fluorides, heavy metals,
yes,
those are all things that tend to be highly prevalent in the area. And so to be able to watch out for those, but like you said, like I never thought about it, but the water, I only moved 24 miles, but the water is potentially very different.
Well, especially if your, and you can find out from if the water company that you're dealing with is a different water company.
Yeah, it is.
Right? So that means the water source is probably different.
It is.
It could have been groundwater where you were, and now it's surface water.
Yeah.
So
it was aquifer before, because I was
okay. Well, okay. And so what is it now? Is it aquifer now?
No, it's lake.
Okay. So that's surface water.
Yeah.
So surface water has higher levels of bacteria, higher levels of that organic matter that creates those disinfection byproducts. So having some information about what might this mean if I have surface water? Oh, it means that you may have higher levels of these things. So I need to make sure that either I'm specifically looking for those in tests, or just as a precaution, I'm going to get filters that address things that are that surface water might be related to.
And I really want to take just a second and step aside and let people know that this isn't meant to like scare you or overwhelm you or,
oh God, no,
you can't drink water anymore, which would be really tough. It's about giving you the education and the information that you need to know so that you can make the best choices to hydrate your body and for cooking and cleaning and everything else so that you can have the healthiest possible, lifestyle. Like that's,
yeah, it's about optimizing our health, yeah, right? So if we're spending extra dollars on organic food, if we're really taking care, if we're practicing mindfulness, meditation, right? If we're doing all these things, let's make sure that our water is not a source of heavy metals and carcinogens, yes, and synthetic, absolutely, estrogens, right?
Just absolutely.
Continuation of that.
It. I love it. Well, thank you so much. As always, I learned so much from you. Like, that's just amazing. And I really appreciate your sharing. Folks, I will put the information down below so that you can connect with Lara and learn more from her course about what is a good option for you, for your geo-individual location.
I love that. I love it.
And we'll be back in touch later. Lara, thank you so much.
You are so welcome.
All right. Talk to you later. Bye.
Bye.